Hello, Internet. Eric here, and today I want to show you this creation. It's a single-seater, fully electric, pure electric plane. It has a 50-foot wingspan, so it's like 25 feet, and it flies very slow. But the thing with electric planes is that, by their very nature, they cannot store. You know, they don't have a long run time, and this becomes a problem because there are rules for minimum fuel level. So if you fly during the VFR weather, which is, you know, clear skies and stuff, you need 30 minutes of reserve fuel minimum. So you need to get on top. So let's say that you're going from A to B, you need to get on top of, you know, by the time you get on top of the destination airport, you should have at least half an hour if you do it during the daytime. And during the night VFR, so nighttime but flying using, you know, your eyes, looking out the window, it's gonna be 45 minutes of fuel under normal cruising power settings. And if you want to fly IFR, it's also 45 minutes, I think, but a safe number is 1 hour. So because electric planes, by their very design, by their very nature, don't have long runtime, so it becomes super important, especially for like trainers and stuff, to for these planes to, you know, get the most out of their, get the most runtime out of their batteries, and this can come at least, cost of range, because if I, you know, this wing is fairly efficient, this plane gets a glide ratio of 24, you'll see at a moment after I take off. But you know, if I made the wings even more glider like I could get more, you know, more range out of this. But the downside will be that I will have higher power consumption in on the prop end, because you know, as the plane goes faster, the prop becomes less efficient, so I'm gonna actually use more power. So if I have glider wings on this plane, it'll fly, you know, this wing is already fairly glider-like, but if I have like even, you know, more glider-like wings, I'm sure this plane would go further, but it would also use more energy and end up, you know, your legal range or your safe amount of range would be less than if I used this design. Now, let's talk about these numbers. 800 pounds, this is the empty weight of the plane. Combined with, you know, battery and, you know, fuselage, motor, and all that. So the way I reached 800 pounds is that, you know, you assume that you have like a 400 pound frame and stuff, and then you have like a, you know, 400 pound electric system with a, you know, 300 pound battery, which gives us a 24 kilowatt hours. And you see 6,000 here because X-Plane has a weird bug where, you know, consumption is like, motors actually consume only a quarter the amount of energy they're supposed to consume. So I downsized the battery in this, you know, in the stats in order to give it a, you know, the real figure. And so yeah, it has a 24 kilowatt hour battery and a 30 horsepower motor. So that's the 400 pounds, and the 300 pound, you know, 300-ish pound, you know, 350 or so pound figure for the battery comes from the BMW i3, which uses a, which, you know, the previous generations used a 24 kilowatt hour 300 pound battery. So that's how I got this number. And let's play, as you can see here, the payload currently is 300 pounds. Now that's just one person. This thing can only seat one person, but I want, you know, fat people to be able to enjoy this plane. But really, normally you're not gonna, the normal amount of payload is gonna be 200 pounds. That's the normal amount of payload. So I weigh less, and some people weigh more, but generally, yeah, that would be a normal amount of payload. So bear in mind that if, you know, you move the slider all the way to 300 pounds, you're gonna see a lot more energy usage. But for the sake of this demonstration, because you know, I want to show you the worst case scenario, so you know just how capable this plane is. We're gonna go with the assumption that, you know, we have a fat ass sitting in the plane, we wanna you know, go out on a flight. So, what else is significant about this plane? Oh yeah, it's electric. So, it's so these are the preliminary stats. They're not like final, but they're just how I tested it. This plane, when loaded at the normal load, so at 1,000 pounds, it'll do 500 feet per minute at 12,000 feet, which is its operational ceiling, since I don't want to like put any pressurization systems. Because you know, you don't want to go high in electric planes because you're going to spend all of that energy climbing, and you're not going to get nearly as much energy back during your descent. And you know, in a normal gas plane, since you have tons of energy available, so you can spend some of, you know, if you want to go on a 500 mile, you know, cross country, then definitely climb up to 10,000. If you can, but not this plane. This plane can't, you know. This plane, you know, if you climb up to 12,000, you know, I did the test with a 1,000 pound, you know, gross weight, and it'll eat up half your battery. So it'll eat up 3,000 kilowatt hours in the software, which means it'll eat up 12 kilowatt hours off your battery in real life. No, it'll eat up, yeah, 12 kilowatt hours of your battery, and that'll leave you with only about another hour or so of flight before you run dry. And that also means that you'll only have like 30 minutes of legal flying before you have to land. And yeah, because it's an electric motor, so the performance actually stays pretty similar, you know, regardless of whether you're at, you know, 0 feet or at 12,000 feet. But the prop, it's designed, it's a fixed pitch prop, and you know, I haven't really decided on the, you know, electric motor's gearing, but it shouldn't be hard to figure it out. You actually don't need gearing because electric motors have lots of torque, and it's a 30 horsepower motor, as I said. And the efficiency figure of 0.85 is based on the Prius motors' efficiency graphs, which, you know, there's a point, sort of a average point on the graph that says 0.85. So that's the assumption I'm making. At 12,000 feet, at 40 knots indicated, 50 knots true, the full throttle, the engine gauge will be, the rotor will do a 2700 RPM, although your cruise setting is 2000. So if you just use this plane normally, which is, you know, slow and, you know, gentle, you won't ever redline the plane, but you'll come perilously close because the red line is at 27,000. But that's just an arbitrary number. Electric motors, they can actually go faster, but I didn't want, you know, I could have put a 100 horsepower motor in it since, you know, motors are very light, so it doesn't really matter. But because if I put a 30 horsepower motor, then, you know, it physically limits the propeller to a efficient speed, because, you know, once tip mach gets into the 0.65s, it'll start, you know, experiencing major tip losses, so I wanted this rotor to spin slow, and one way to do that while saving a bit of weight is to, you know, use a lower power motor. So now that's out of way, let's get started. So yeah, we are parked at this ramp here, and we're just gonna taxi over to this runway and then take off. And I'm gonna give you an idea of the performance of this plane. So yeah, this plane, because the rotor is so, you know, it's a 30 horsepower rotor, so you actually need quite a bit of throttle to get it moving, since, you know, normally you would rotate at 35 knots, which isn't that far from like 10 knots, so you need a lot of like throttle. And yeah, as you can see on the readout, if I throttle down, it'll give me a tiny bit of regeneration. Now, of course, in such a small plane, like if you have a bigger electric plane, you might want to install, you know, electric motors, rotor, you know, motors in the wheels so that you don't have to run the propellers to pull the plane. You know, this is inefficient, but you know, in a small plane like this, weight savings is more important than and complexity savings is more important than, you know, getting your absolute best amount of, and also I don't know how to program electric motors, you know, motorized wheels in next plane, so that's another thing. Yeah, this plane, so yeah, with full flaps it'll stall at like 20 knots at 1,000 pounds. The wings come at a cant, so if I take you to the side of this, you can see that. Well, I'm not sure if you can see it, but you know, relative to the angle, because the propeller is actually not angled in any way, so yeah, but because the front gear is slightly longer, so the plane looks like it's nosing up. But yeah, relative to the rest of the plane, the wings are at a 3.5 degree angle with the wingtips at a 3 degree angle, so that you get a bit of control near stall, you know, roll control near stall. So yeah, and we just have a fairly standard elevator, ailerons, and rudder. As you can see, because this is not a this is not a gas plane, so we don't really need, you know, big ass intake, so we can do a pointy nose here. And yeah, the landing gear, you know, you can fare it, you probably save a tiny bit of electricity, but it's not a major concern. And yeah, it's a low wing aircraft, so you'll just have to crab it, but it shouldn't be a problem because, you know, you can slow down to 30 knots if you have to. So, you know, at 30 knots, it's like even if you slide it side loaded, it's not going to be do huge da a hu huge amount of damage, because that's, you know, at 30 knots, you know, pretty much maintain a alpha, a angle of attack of 0 degrees, well, 2 degrees actually. So it's not a big deal that this plane is a low wing aircraft. And this plane also wouldn't qualify as a ultralight, even though it's pretty light, because mainly because of the battery, big ass battery. That makes it more practical, but also make it not a legal ultralight, because ultralights have to be 250 pounds or less empty weight, and they can only carry 5 gallons, or, you know, so 5 gallons, which is 30 pounds of fuel, or 30 pounds of, so if you wanted to make a electric plane, electric ultralight, you can only put 30 pounds of batteries in it, which means like 2 seconds of flying, which is no fun. So anyway, yeah, so that's why we have you know, so this is designed to be a real airplane to be flown by I don't want to say flight schools because there's only one seat, but know, by private citizens who just want to build some hours, you know, go nearby. Except preliminarily, speaking, this thing should have a range of about hundred and well, it should have a you know, f its absolute range should be about 150 miles, but its real world range, its usable range, would be about 100 miles with, you know, with reserves. If you want to have some reserves, you know, 100, 120 miles. You know, the lower you cruise, the better, because, you know, and it's not because, you know, because the lower you cruise, you know, because the FAA rules define, you know, the fuel minimums as the fuel needed to at a normal cruise. So if you're at a lower altitude cruise, you're using less fuel, so your minimum battery state of charge requirements would be less, and that would allow you to actually go further, paradoxically, even though, you know, you would think, oh, and also because you don't want to spend all of your energy gaining altitude, because, you know, 50, you know, 100 miles of horizontal distance, you're gonna gain like 1 or 2 miles of vertical distance, and that's not worth it. But of course, this plane also has the capability to go all the way up to, I'm gonna guess, like, if you want to run battery dry, you can go all the way up to 18,000 feet. If you bring some oxygen and stuff. But anyway, so we're on the runway and throttle full. Because this plane is such a high, it has such a low takeoff speed, so generally there is no like short field takeoff. Like this is the short field takeoff. You're not gonna save any takeoff distance by, all right, rotate. You're not gonna save any takeoff distance by dropping flaps. All right, we're just gonna use the autopilot here, and I'm gonna set the heading to 090. Right, so I haven't done much testing on its stall characteristics, but it shouldn't be awful. Anyway, so we're gonna aim for a cruise altitude of about 2,000 feet or so, which is above 1,000 AGL, and it's not a particular. I mean, if your engine fails, which can happen, you're gonna have 22. So you're gonna have about 20,000 feet, which is about 3 miles of gliding range. So it's not a huge concern, for engine failure, and because you stall at like 20 knots, so you can just gently land on any patch of land. So low altitude cruise is not really a danger in this aircraft. Of course you still have to be aware of not flying into terrain, but that's another story. That's not the same as engine failures. So yeah, we're gonna climb to 2,000 and then just stay there. Now, as you can see, we're climbing at 400 feet per minute, but that's because in this, we are a 300-pound fat ass. But if I said at 1,000 pounds, the plane will climb at 500 feet per minute. And of course, if you're lighter than 200 pounds, then the plane will perform even better. It'll be hugely dependent on the amount of weight you carry. So obviously, smaller people will get an advantage flying this plane, because they'll be able to go further legally. But of course, then comes the matter of charging it, which I don't have a good answer. So for the meantime, it is limited to its effective range, which is it's limited to like within a 50-mile radius of your home airport. Right, so yeah, because we are fully loaded, so I'm actually gonna increase my climb speed to 45. At 2,000 pounds, your climb speed should be at your climb and cruise speed should be 40. It's not the best speed for maximizing your range, but because you're going slower, you are using less power per hour, which gives you more time in the air, and that makes this a great time builder, since you're gonna be getting 2 hours of flight on a about, I want to say, half a gallon's worth of energy. Half a gallon's gas worth of energy. So that's a fairly good, decent amount of, that's a decent price. Of course, then comes another problem of, okay, because you're the slow thing and this can't be ultralight, so you have to fly above. You can't actually go low, but it'll be unsafe, below like 700 AGL, or in class G airspace, sometimes it's 1200 feet, sometimes it's 700 feet. But you can go low, but if you want to fly into real airports, you're slower than every other plane out there, so you're gonna cause a huge inconvenience. So you have to like do probably you probably have to do like short approaches. You have to I'm not sure if you're allowed to like just fly at a lower TPA, probably not. But you know, there are special concerns that need to be noted when you're flying such a efficient type and slow type of aircraft. And you know, like, you know, you're gonna wanna, like, if you don't want to annoy the people behind you, you might wanna approach a runway at just without flaps. All right, so we're at 2,000 feet, and you know, the optimal most aerodynamic speed at 2,000 feet is 45 knots indicated. Well, no, at fully loaded, as a fully loaded plane is 45 knots indicated, and I can't. You know, I haven't done conclusive tests since I just modified this plane to create this version just now, so, but yeah, that's the reference numbers for now. All right, so we are accelerating. So yeah, the benefits of such a plane are obviously, you know, maintenance. It's gonna be basically maintenance free since you don't need oil, and you know, motors are cheap to, I guess, maintain, and you know, overhaul. You know, if your motor reaches like, you know, 1,000 hours, you can just swap it out for a new one, and of course, operating costs are gonna be a real benefit. But also like, and also because you already have a battery system, so you don't need like extra batteries in plane. And yeah, of course the downsides of this plane in particular is that it only seats one, and of course it's slow, and you can't really use it as transportation. You can only use it as for time building and stuff. But you know, it's easy to learn, right? Because it's, you know, electric motors are mostly reliable, and you're not gonna fall out of the sky. So yeah, as you can see right now at this cruise setting, we're consuming 6,000 watts, 6,300 watts, which at a remaining charge of 55 times 4, so that's like 20. 2 kilowatt hours, so that's about 3 to 4 hours of flight time, and about 2 hours of endurance, which means that we'll have about 100 miles of range, 100 nautical miles of range. And you know, I'm gonna try going slower. So right now, as you can see, the peak is about 6,300 watts. So let's go slower. And of course, yeah, derp. All right. So another benefit of electric aircraft is that because the motor is efficient over a wide RPM range. So you know, if you're a gas plane, all right, the most, you know, unless it's an Atkinson cycle engine, in which case, you know, the trade-off is going to be, oh, yeah, sure, you're going to get better fuel economy, but you're going to have a better specific fuel consumption, but the engine. And the engine is going to be flexible over a large RPM range, but it's also going to be heavier. It's gonna also going to have less power density. But for an electric motor, like, you know, right now we're outputting 8 horsepower, and in theory, you know, the performance graphs show that it's about, you know, its lowest point is about like a 77% efficiency, and its highest point is about a 91% efficiency. But it's pretty much, you know, you're pretty much at the same efficiency throughout all the RPM ranges. So you can go at, you know, 1758 RPM and still, so yeah, we're definitely consuming more because this is technically, this should be considered a slow flight. Let's go back to 45. All right, so I'm just gonna demonstrate, you know, what if you're a 200-pound person? And now, since you're a 200-pound person, we can slow down to 40. Now, note the reduced power use. It's going to be very significant. Because, you know, we're gaining efficiency not only, you know, needing to carry less people, you know, less payload, but also because we're slower, the propeller itself, you know, the conversion of power into thrust is going to be more efficient. So, you know, if you rewind the video and do the math, this would be a, you know, this, the ratio of power over thrust is going to be higher in the, you know, if you have more people, more person in the plane, or more cargo in the plane. So yeah, as you can see, now that we've got rid of 100 pounds, hey, we've reduced our power use by about 800 watts, which gives us a very solid about 3 hours of runtime, which means that 3 hours for 47 miles is about 150 miles of range. So yeah, that allows you to do a, you know, cross country, you know, assuming there's no wind. You know, that is the kind of range that allows you to do a cross country. As long as you don't mind doing a cross country at 2,000 feet above ground. But of course, a benefit of this, you know, because it's electric, so, you know, it's not as affected by high altitude as other planes, and that also makes it more suitable for a wide range of terrain. Like, this, you know, its climb rate will drop to 500 feet per minute at 12,000 feet, but, you know, if you start your flight at, let's say, you know, in, I don't know, the Rockies, where you start at 12,000 feet, you can go all the way up to, like, 24,000 feet before you run out of charge and have to glide back down. And this makes it a fantastic glider. A glide ratio of 24, you know, lift drag is basically the same as glide, and we have a glide ratio of 24 right now. So yeah, it's a very cool design, and, you know, like, this, yeah, sure, it's gonna take some ingenuity, but, you know, the battery weight estimates are using modern technology, and, you know, there already exist, like, you know, single-seater planes like the Cri-Cri that only weigh like 300 pounds, I think, 300 or 400 pounds, depending on configuration. But, you know, you can definitely, like, it's a weight target that is definitely achievable. But of course, one of the downsides that make it a bit harder is that this airfoil is a very nice airfoil that I'm not sure you'll be able to get in, because it requires a smooth, laminar flow airfoil. So yeah, it provides better lift than all the other airfoils. But the downside is I'm not sure you'll be able to make it in real life without some special. But then again, you know, if, you know, electric planes won't come cheap. Electric planes won't come cheap. But still, I estimate that at least the building costs, you know, in terms of, like, raw material and stuff, will be, like, maybe $60,000 for this plane. You know, at least in my mind, the worth would be $60,000. You'll probably want to sell it for, you know, if, you know, you're a company and you build these planes, you'll probably want to sell it for... Let me come up with a figure. For maybe like 200,000. I don't know, man. I'm gonna look up the 172. So yeah, a brand new 172 costs 300,000. So I figure you can probably sell a plane, sell this for that number. So it'll, like, carry three less people, although realistically it's only, like, two less people. And, you know, you'll save a crap ton on operating costs, and it'll be more reliable, and because you're electric, you're gonna have a smooth ride. You know, normally in aviation, if you want a smooth ride, you have to go up to jets and turboprops. But here, you know, it's just a motor up front, and you can have a smooth ride. So yeah, if the FAA didn't exist and, you know, everyone could just build whatever, this would cost $60,000 to make, and it's going to be incredible fun. Although, of course, you're going to be about in terms of like a straight line displacement, you're going to be about as fast as the cars on the ground, but you know, you're going to be into the air, and you're going to be able to, you know, do island hopping that, you know, gas cars can't, you know, that cars can't do without like taking boats and stuff. Right, so yeah, I'm going to show you one more configuration. So yeah, that's so this is what the FAA says my weight is. So this is my configuration. But you know, let's just do 150 so that, you know, you get a more varied estimate. So 150. Watch our. We're going to reduce power use some more. So yeah, if you run a normal car, like you know, there's a gas car, you know, when driving, there's a hypermiling method called pulse and glide, where you know you accelerate for about at a higher RPM for about, you know, a few seconds, you know, up to 10 miles per hour higher, and then you let off the throttle and then coast down back to, you know, like let's say that you're oscillating between 55 and 75, so you accelerate at like a, you know, 70% throttle, 70% throttle from 55 to 75, and then you let off the throttle and then glide back down to 55 and then repeat. And this is actually more efficient than just maintaining the correct throttle setting for a 65 miles an hour cruise, because you are running the engine at its more efficient RPM range. Well, not in electric motors, because you know, at 31% throttle, this plane, you know, and it's like this figure is gonna be good. It's gonna be real. Meanwhile, you know, in a gas plane at 31% throttle, it's not gonna be efficient, or it's not gonna be as efficient. All right, so yeah, now that this is stabilized, and we're only using 5,000 watts of power, so that means we get a solid 4 hours, well, 3.5 hours out of this, like for an IFR flight, for a and for a night VFR flight. Well, not for your IFR flight, depending on, you know, because you know, if you go IFR, then in addition to the 45 minutes, you'll still need an additional 30 minutes of fuel to your alternate, and that's no fun. You can't do it. Not in this plane. Well, no, yes you can. So that's about 1.25 hours. So you know, you would still have about 100 miles of range for an IFR flight. So yeah, so if you're a lighter person, you can get more range. So, and I'm not gonna do 100 pounds, because if you're 100 pounds, you probably shouldn't be flying. Or at least you shouldn't be flying something like this. So anyway, weight and fuel, weight back to 100 pounds, 200 pounds. All right, so at zero throttle and clean configuration, actually, I'm going to go back to 300 pounds. So yeah, you gotta be very careful not to overload this, because since it doesn't burn fuel, it's gonna, you know, whatever performance you get is whatever you get. It's gonna not gonna get lighter as you fly, unless you throw things out the window. All right, so now what was I gonna do? Oh yeah, so let's say that, you know, you're descending. So at a clean configuration like this, so you have a about a let's just go up to a 45 knots. So at a clean configuration, 45 knots, and then let's maintain speed. So now we're gliding at a speed, so I've reduced throttle to zero. And so yeah, you know, so yeah, right now we're gliding down at about, I'm gonna let it stabilize a bit. But yeah, you're not gonna exceed 300 feet per minute on a glide. So yeah, if you're a 300-pound person, or if you have 300 pounds of payload, you're gonna glide down at a glide ratio of awesomeness, but specifically you're going to glide down at a glide ratio of about 26 with a 300 feet per minute glide, and you're going to generate about 2,000 kilowatts of power while you do it. Now if you're a 200 pound person and you're going to want to glide down at 40 knots, well, I guess 45 would have been a fine number, but whatever. No, it's alright. So yeah, at a 40 knot glide, your glide ratio will be 25. And your engine will, you know, you're going to be generating 1.6 kilowatts of power. So you're going to be feeding 1.6 kilowatts of power back into your avionics and back into your battery. And I'm not going to do the 150 pound, no, because you get it, you get the idea. So yeah, so I'm going to set max gross, and let's climb back up to 2,000. So yeah, I'm thinking, like, if you want to go fast, it's actually better to, you know, put some weights into planes so that, you know, you're not at a negative angle of attack, because I'm actually not sure that it's probably, you know, a heavy plane is probably less efficient than a light plane at a negative angle of attack, you know, for the same speed. But to 45, and yeah, as you can see, we're climbing at 370 feet per minute, but because we're only going 45 knots, it's all right. All right, so now I'm going to show you the plane's approach configuration. So we're going to climb up to 2,000 feet, still climbing. So yeah, a slower plane, because you're only one a single pilot, so a slower plane also gives you more time to think and plan stuff. Alright, so we're going to slow down to 35 knots. And there's no retractable gear, but we do have flaps. We're going to drop one stage of flaps. So this is like for an absolute short field. Alright, so we're going to drop one stage of flap to slow us down. And the second stage of flap. And now the plane's gonna throttle back up. So yeah, we have three stages, you know, like in the Cessna, we have three stages of flaps in total. So, you know, you have 10, 20, and 30 degrees. So yeah, let's slow to 30 knots and drop the final stage of flap. So yeah, you're now at 30 knots, which with pretty much a level, slightly high nose attitude. So yeah, this is what the forces look like at a 30 knot, you know, level flight. And you know, the autopilot doesn't go that far, but you know, you can easily do a 25 knot slow flight in this plane. So yeah, now let's do a 30 knot glide. So you can see that, you know, if your engine fails, you can drop your flaps. If the motor fails, actually, because, you know, there is no engine, you can drop your flaps and then just fly it down at 30 knots, which will produce a glide ratio of 9, and a descent rate of 3 Freddy. Yeah, that's what this figure will give you. Now, if you want to climb out at 30 knots, so with full throttle, oh shit, I haven't even showed you the amount of power generated yet. So yeah, 30 knots, the amount of power you'll generate is about 500 watts. So yeah. So yeah, this is climbing. So if you climb out at 30 knots, you're only gonna make about 200 feet per minute. Now contrast this to 400 feet per minute at 40 knots. So you'll see why, this, dropping flaps isn't such a good option for a short field takeoff. Anyway, let's set speed back to a 45 and raise flaps. Raise flaps. And raise flaps. All right. So yeah, now I guess what I should do is one. Well, I guess I could do a emergency. Well, yeah, let's just locate a nearby short field. There is no. Well, I guess Myricks will do. It's about a northerly heading, so yeah, we'll try Myricks. So let's set the autopilot to zero, a heading of zero. Oh yeah, and another benefit of, only flying 2,000 AGL is that you don't have to worry about cruise altitude because you are below the minimum altitude at which, at which the odd and even plus 500 rule, or if you're flying high FR, just odd and even matters. So I'm going to descend to 1500. And yeah, we still have a 48 times 4 equals about 20. 20 kilowatt hours of charge left. So, are we heading in the right direction? Center on aircraft. Oh, we're over here. Yeah, I thought this was us. This isn't us. This is another one of my creations. Like, all these silhouettes, you can barely see them, but these are all my creations. So yeah, so we're actually this is a helicopter field, so we can't do that. But we can do a 2 Bravo 1, which is about a this is 90, this is a 135 vector. All right, so let's go 135. And to th speed things up, this thing is capable, I think, of a 65 knot glide. Although I am not sure. So you can use this to look at the airflow. Can I go past 61? So yeah, as you can see, our glide ratio is still pretty badass. It's still like 24. But now we are descending at a much more reasonable 500 feet per minute rate. So if you're at in a pattern, you can just use no flaps and 65 all the way. And then if you need to drop altitude, just do a slip. And of course, if your plane's lighter, then yeah, it's still the same principle. All right, throttle up. So let's check our location in relation to the to 2 Bravo 1. And yeah, it's good. So yeah, at 65 knots, you're still not using a ton of energy, but basically, you're, I don't want to say double. I guess we should just wait for the energy figures. But yeah, basically at 65 knots, you're consuming 150% more energy than if you are going, you know, per distance, you know, 50% more energy. Well, actually, is it 50%? Well, it's more than 50%. Because, you know, about 10 divided by 60 is a number. So yeah, it's pretty much like 150% the energy you would be using if you just cruised at 45 knots indicated, which means that now in order to now you are actually in violation of the, well, you're not, because we still have like four, you know, about slightly less than 20 kilowatt hours left. But that does mean that you only have 1 hour of flying left, and a 1 hour flying equals 66 miles. So that means that your total range is going to be 90 miles instead of 110 or 120 miles if you fly conservatively. And also it means that, you know, if you want to, you know, if your goal is to build time, then you can't build time because you're going at 65 miles an hour. So you're only going to gain 1 hour of time as opposed to, well, yeah, you're only going to gain like 1.3 hours of time as opposed to like 2 hours of flight time. Right, so how far away are we? So yeah, and also at this speed, you're also like 2400 RPM. Although again, it is my understanding that the red line in the Cessna, you know, for the Romeo, it's like 2400 RPM, and for the SP, it's like 2600 or 2700 RPM. The red line is not so much about really the engine limitations as much as it's about noise regulation, because, you know, 2400 RPM is quieter than like 27 or 30. So yeah, so you know, I don't think electric motors will really be limited to 2700 RPM, especially for a 30 horsepower electric motor that's slightly small and will likely spin very fast. But so yeah, it's not a huge limitation, but just be aware of that. At this speed, you're also, your propeller, you know, if you do the math, 12 divided by 50, it's less efficient than if you than the propeller at 45 knots. Like, even though like this is the propeller efficiency index, but this doesn't take into account certain things. Let's just put it that way. So yeah, so if, let's say, you know, you're testing different propeller configurations for at the same speed at the same RPM, then yes, this tool will be useful. But this tool is not useful at the when you are not at a different RPM. You know, this tool is not useful for when you are at different RPMs. When you're at different RPMs, it's more important to compare, well, if you want just the propeller efficiency, it's more important to compare power to thrust conversion. And if you want fuel economy, it's engine use or fuel flow compared to your speed. Now let's look at the local map. How close are we? So yeah, just 1, 2, 3 pawns. That's 1, 2, 3 pawns. Trying to figure this out. So yeah, anyway, let's descend down to 1100. So yeah, at this speed, at 65 knots, we're generating 5 kilowatt hours, well, 5 kilowatts of power in a 65 knot glide. Of course, this power generation figure is also not entirely realistic, but I don't know. But you know, it provides some degree of realism. So yeah, I'm guessing that is Cape Cod. Alright, so I'm just gonna do a bit of time acceleration here. So yeah, one thing, this plane will not be as fast. It's gonna be a slow plane. And that means, like, you know, you can't fly on headwinds. Not that you should be anyway, because, you know, these large wings mean that you can't really handle turbulence very well. Alright, now I'm gonna locate a runway. That seems like a runway. Alright, so let's head towards the runway. Autopilot off. And full throttle. I don't care about redlining. Alright, 27, 28, 29. So yeah, right now, as you can see, our glide ratio is 10, which is still not the most horrible. And we are going at 100 knots. So yeah, we can actually do a super tight approach because the plane is slow. Not that it's slow right now, but it can be slow later. So yeah, right now we're doing about 100 knots. So I guess in level flight, at full throttle, you can probably do 100 knots. Is your speed limit indicated? That is. So you know, if you go up to like say 20,000 feet, you can probably do 150 knots. True airspeed. Alright, so I've pulled power. And now, we're gonna slow down. And I'm just gonna try a typical, no flaps approach because, you know, you don't really wanna go so slow that, you know, cause a traffic jam in the air. Because, you know, at a 30 knot approach speed, really, it's really gonna take forever. So yeah, alright, we have our gears, our stuff. 50 knots. Remember, our best glide is about 45. So this really isn't a huge concern. Anyway, now that we're over at field, drop flaps. See, I'm thinking I want the flaps to be able to have a extension, you know, maximum extension speed of at least 65 knots, because I want them to be able to be used as speed brakes when you need them. Because this plane is just too efficient. Alright. We're at 40 knots. We're coming down. Alright. Cool. But yeah, just gonna give you a bit of the sound. I'm just gonna... Alright, so this is idle sound, which is quiet. And then... That's what it sounds like. I'm not sure how accurate that sound is, but that's what it sounds like. Anywho, let's just taxi over to, so yeah, like our... Let's just taxi over to, and of course, retract your flaps so you don't accidentally fly into the sky. It's for a tricycle, it's not too shabby either. Alright, so I'm thinking, like, I don't know where the parking spaces are, but I'm assuming this is one. So yeah, because for electric motors, you can't really, like, unlike gas engines, which, you know, you need both fuel and the starter motors to really start up, you know, with this, it's just that. You probably want like a propeller, you know, some rod to like lock the propeller so that you don't accidentally throttle up. And cause, like, you know, there's not gonna be really any reason to touch the propeller, but still, you know, in case of like a short circuit or something, you don't want the propeller to accidentally speed up and hurt someone. Yeah, and just in case you're wondering, this plane definitely has no regenerative braking. Alright, so let's do some calculations here. So we traveled 33.87 nautical miles. Actually, I'm just gonna show you my we're just gonna use our fuel efficiency calculator here. So yeah. We moved, .87 nautical miles, alright? And we used, well, we started out with 6,000 watt-hours, and we ended up with 4,389. So that's, about 1,700 watt-hours. And then, alright, so that's 1611 watt hours. Now, that's the indicated usage. The actual usage is this times 4, which equals to 6,444 watt hours. Now, sorry, a gallon of gasoline contains about, let's say, 33 kilowatt hours. So that's kilowatt hours. Now, 33 kilowatt hours divided by 6.4 kilowatt hours equals, oh no, 6.4 divided by 33 equals 19.5. So it's 0.195 gallons. So for 33.87. So 33.87 divided by 0.195 gallons equals 173 miles per gallon equivalent. So that's how efficient this plane is. It's more efficient than motorcycles. Well, no, not electric motorcycles, but every other motorcycle. And also probably most, because, you know, motorbikes on the road tend to have, you know, motorbikes aren't very aerodynamic. This is a very aerodynamic design. So yeah, anyway. Alright, so that's just a playback to show you the landing. Wow, this isn't... Well, that's not a whole lot of playback duration. I really hate this aspect of a X-plane, is that you don't really get a lot of playback for some reason. I don't know what setting to change. Anyway, so here's us coming in for a landing with our flaps. Alright, so that there is our touchdown point. Alright, so that's about the second, you know, the start of the third strike. Alright. There was a bit of a bounce there. And then pretty much, so yeah, from here to here, this is our ground roll. So that's 300 feet. So yeah, that was our landing. Anywho, so that's it for, so yeah, that's just me showing you what this plane can do. And of course, if we extrapolate from this figure, so, you know, if we can do 33.87 miles on this number, then 4389 divided by 1611. Equals this, and then times 33.87 equals, you know, even with that kind of inefficient flying, we can still do at least 125 miles in total of just like random aerobatic, well, not really aerobatic, but, you know, just random flying. And that at a speed of 50 miles an hour or 50 knots is 2 hours off flying, and one hour left off flying. So yeah, so it's pretty cool. And also electric planes have the benefit since you don't lose weight over time, so there is no need to adjust the throttle setting once you are in cruise. So yeah, that's it for this video. I will provide a link to this plane in the comment, well, in the description box. And yeah, I'll see you next time, and until next time, stuff happens.